So for people who are just coming in, if you hadn't heard, if you're having trouble with any of the instructions here, like getting Vagrant and VirtualBox installed if it's not, or getting your VM up, just raise your hand nice and high, and then one of us will come around and help you. Awesome. If you don't have a USB key, also, because you're going to need that.
Yeah. Okay. Just want to make sure it's in copy.
It's close to.
Somebody just going into that directory and doing the deal. Real slow. I think it'd be slow. And we'll have to benchmark. Get some data. For the next time you do it? Yeah. Did you merge Austin into master?
Oh yeah. Any critical requests after the session's done?
Yeah. Yeah, just a reminder, if you guys are running Windows, and make sure you have some sort of SSH client to connect into your Vagrant machine, so.
Remember, if you're having any problems, just stick your hands up.
Or if you don't have a key or anything like that, just any problems whatsoever, raise those hands up. Raise the roof.
So has everyone managed to run the Vagrant SSH command? I think silence means yes.
Yeah, so just to be clear, like we're talking about, once you have got your USB key, stuck it in your computer, copied files over, that's awesome and done. If you're on Windows, you have an SSH client of some sort. We've copied the files over. So wherever you copy the files over, you're going to open a terminal up. If you've got VirtualBox and Vagrant installed, and then you can, in a terminal, change into the Designate Workshop folder. You can do Vagrant up, and that'll start up a VM for you, and then Vagrant SSH, and then you'll be logged onto that machine. So if that sounds super confusing or you're stuck on any one of those steps, just raise your hand, and we'll come help you out. And if you've already done that, then that's great. That's good. We're moving right along.
All right, let's try this one more way. Raise your hand if you are 100% ready to go. You're staring at the Vagrant prompt. Okay. Put those hands down. If you didn't raise your hand and you do want to participate in the workshop, raise those hands now. All right, that's how we do that. Okay, keep those hands up if you need help. No, it just nobody needs help. All right, so maybe we give it a couple more minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah, go help him out. Now he's got a friend. I'm just gonna keep talking into the microphone. You're the winner. If you're just coming in and you don't have a USB key, get at Kyle right there in the middle of the room. And if you're having any problems, raise that hand nice and high and somebody will come and help you out.
So, is there anyone else who hasn't managed to vagrant SSH yet? Okay, there's still a few, so we'll give it a couple of minutes. Eric, behind you.
All right, hands up one more time, because I wasn't paying attention. All right, so quick show of hands, if you still need some help or a USB key or anything, we got one, we got, raise those hands nice and high so the folks walking around can see. All right, we'll probably just give it another minute here and then we're gonna get started. We'll put a link to these slides in the probably in like the feedback session, like the feedback section on the app or something. I don't know. We'll get you these slides if you need them. But most of the stuff is in the actual machine that you can keep.
That's pretty nice. In the back, looks like there's someone can use some help.
Okay, so is nearly everyone or everyone at a prompt at the in the VM?
Sweet.
Is anyone not that isn't being looked after?
I think we can give everybody a hand for that.
Okay.
That's good.
Well,
good
done,
work,
everybody.
Everybody.
Okay, I'll give a quick introduction then while everyone else is catching up. My name is Graham Hayes. I am the PTL for the Designate project. And thank you for coming to the workshop. It's always a great experience to show people how to install our software and how to use it. So Designate is a DNS as a service product inside of OpenStack. It's a way you can enable end users to manage DNS entries a lot easier than trying to sync zone files or what a lot of other people have had to do in the past, write custom in-house solutions for managing DNS. So Designate is made up of a couple of components, which we'll show you how to install today. We have an API service, which is how we interact with users directly. We have the central service, which is where we keep all our business logic. This has access to the database. It also enforces that people can't take over other people's DNS zones and ensures that everything is being done in accordance with the rules set out in the policy file and in the configuration file. We also have a service called Designate Mini DNS, which is a DNS server which we wrote in Python. This allows us to interact very easily with a wide range of DNS servers. So Designate doesn't actually serve DNS directly to end users. We interact with other servers like PowerDNS or Bind or NSD. And because we use standard DNS for pushing out the information, it means that it's a lot more reliable and we can support a lot of DNS servers very quickly with very little code required. So we have myself presenting today. We also have Kyle McGinnis, who's walking around somewhere, he's down the back. We both work in Hewlett Packard Enterprise as part of the DNS as a service team. From Rackspace, we have Tim Simmons and Eric Larson. Eric is here, Tim is
over here.
Oh, sorry, he's right behind the lights. And we have Miguel Lavelle from IBM, who will be showing some of the integration between Nova, Neutron, and Designate as part of the install. So with that, if everyone's ready, I'll hand over to Eric, who will be showing you how to install Designate.
All right. So we're going to install this sucker. It's going to be cool. You guys are going to enjoy this. So here's a big diagram that more or less goes over all the pieces that we're going to get up and running. All right, so everybody's got your Vagrant image set up. You can SSH into it, so we're going to go ahead and start. So this is really simple. We have Vagrant SSH, so you're into your machine, and in your folder, there's a script. And the script is install-designate.shell. And here we are. So we have this workshop here, and we have this script. And I'm just going to, you can go ahead and run the script. Yes, in your Vagrant environment, after you SSH in, you can just go and run the script. I already started hitting the cap lock key. All right. So, and as you guys run this script, we're going to go ahead and look at it so you guys can see all the stuff that's happening. Oh, goodness gracious. So basically, some of the script is here to make sure you guys can run it and rerun it. So there's going to be some things that'll delete the stuff that would have been created, and it'll recreate it. So I'm going to kind of ignore those sorts of things and just go through the basics. So basically, it starts off, we change it to a directory. This is a checkout of the Designate source code. And we do a pip install. And so we install based on the requirements.txt, and then we install that local environment into your system Python environment. Next up, we copy over some config files. So when you check out Designate, there's a bunch of config files in the etc directory, and those files are what you'd want to start with. So that's effectively what we're doing here, is you go and you can list the files. They have a dot sample, so we're just lopping off that dot sample and putting them in the Etsy directory for you. So next up, we're actually going to go and use a preset set of values that we've written for you. So we're going to copy over a designate.conf.workshop to designate.conf. So that, if you guys need a reference as you guys are going home and you're on your plane or what have you, traveling home, you said, man, I want to look at that config file again. That's the one. That's the one you can take a look at and check it out. The other file that you're going to be, you might be interested in is this pools.yaml. We'll talk about that a little bit later as once we configure the pools. So there's a couple bookkeeping things that happen there that are not terribly important, but something you might need later. Next up, we're going to go and create our database. Pretty simple stuff. And then the important part here is we call designate manage. So designate manage is a command line tool that helps you manage your designate instance. So this will go and sync your database. So it'll go and create your tables. It'll perform migrations on it and all that sort of stuff. So to get your tables and your database up to par. So after we have our databases in place and everything's looking good and we have Designate installed into our system Python environment, we're going to start the services. So this is starting up the services Graham mentioned. So we have Designate Central. That's going to do stuff like talking to the database for us. We have Designate API. That's going to handle our web traffic. Designate MDNS, or mini DNS, as we say. That's the service that Graham was talking about as far as like this is going to accept DNS traffic to get changes out. And the pool manager. So again, remember a minute ago I said we copied over pools.yaml. We're going to talk about the pool manager and that pools.yaml. And finally, there's the designate zone manager. And that's another service that does things like periodic tasks. So if something fails or you want to do something special like an alias record or something interesting that isn't quite supported just yet, that would be happening in the zone manager. So now that we've started up all the services, we're going to populate our pools database. So again, we're using the designate manage command, and we're going to update our pools based off of that pools.yaml. And I'm going to show you guys that pools.yaml after this. So what does that do? The pools is going to go, and when you have a set of DNS servers, you call those set of DNS servers a pool. And so this pools contains a configuration for those DNS servers. So this says, oh, I have 3 instances of PowerDNS someplace that I want to run. And when I want to create a new zone, I'm going to push out that zone to those 3 instances. So all that is listed in the pool. So we'll look at that file. So here's some stuff just created meant for PowerDNS. So this just syncs some information with our PowerDNS information. So we have one running a local DNS server. We restart PowerDNS just to pick up changes. And then you can see here that we're restarting the pool manager to pick up changes of our pool. So we updated our pools to say, oh, here we have a local pool that's running PowerDNS. Now we're going to restart it to pick up those changes. And then we're going to do some fun stuff by using the OpenStack client. So we're going to go and, I keep scrolling the wrong way. So we're going to source the openrc.admin. So in that file is a bash script, just export some environment variables so you guys can have some admin credentials. So first off, we'll go and it's going to delete our designate service that's already there, just in case you guys run this twice. But more importantly, we're going to create the designate service in Keystone. So that will go and make it so when you log into Keystone, you'll get a DNS entry for your service. You will get a service entry for your DNS service. So you can go and have an endpoint to talk to. You can see we create the endpoint and create the different admin URLs, public URL, internal URL, and region. And then next up, with that in place, we're going to install a designate client. So this just changes into a different directory, Python designate client. And what that does is it's a plugin for the OpenStack command line client. That will install the designate client plugin, so you can go and use the normal OpenStack commands, which we'll show you guys a little bit later. And then last up, we install the designate dashboard. So this is a Horizon, so you'll also get to see a nice UI. Okay, so we just went through the install script. So let's take a quick peek at our the config file. So here, a lot of this should be somewhat similar to other OpenStack projects, I'm hoping. So let me know if not, but more or less, it's just some things that we're setting. Here's some general configuration. This is all annotated, so you guys can look back and hopefully understand what's going on. So I'm just scrolling down to where we get something interesting. So one thing to notice is we have a sudo helper here, and I only mention it because a lot of times bind servers want to be run in sudo, so this lets you go and, for example, if you're running bind, you interact with bind via a tool called rndc, and so this does that sort of setup for you. And then here's some exciting bits, which networking API to use. So we're going to use Neutron. So Miguel's going to show you some awesome stuff with that later. OK, so here's the interesting bit. So here we have the service configuration. So this is where you're configuring our different services. Here we have a central service. You can do things. You can see max domain name length, max record name length, things like that, minimum TTLs for records and things like that. There's a manage resource settings, just to let you guys know what that is. Designate will go and create records and resources for you, and these can be considered managed, in which case Designate owns these things. You don't get to play with them anymore. So this allows you to go and, for example, make sure that SOA records are only managed by Designate and some user doesn't come in and clobber those where that would be a problem. API service, this is just basic, hey, what host port are you going to bind to, those sorts of things. We have authentication strategy. If you are testing this locally, you can just use NoAuth and then you don't have to authenticate. So that's a nice tidbit. Or if you're running it in production, you don't want to do that. We have some enabled extensions. So an important one here is quotas. So quotas lets you go and enable, it allows you to limit how many, for example, zones a user can create, how many record sets a user can create, or how many records a user can create. So those are good things to make sure that you don't just have someone unboundedly creating as much stuff as they want. And there's some admin things that you can also enable. Here's some information on the Keystone middleware. There's a sync service that I don't think we're going to keep talking about. And then here, mini DNS service. So again, this is just this is where you would have things like your bind server talking back to your mini DNS to go and pick up changes, and those get pushed back out to your main server. Agent. So one thing I'll mention about the agent, since it's coming up here, the agent allows you to go and have, if for example you run some other sort of DNS server that we don't know about, you can potentially write like a plugin and use the agent to talk to that DNS server. And this one can be helpful if you have also sort of esoteric setups for your DNS system. So if you're doing something really complicated, the agent's probably a friend. Otherwise, you probably don't need to worry about it. Here's our pool manager service. You can see here we have a pool ID. That's saying, hey, we have a pool that's called this. And we're going to scroll down. I'm going to skip the Neutron stuff real quick. Keep scrolling down to skip the Neutron stuff. Oh, never mind. That's in the pools. Yeah. So I'm going to let you guys take a look at this later because there's a lot of stuff in there and there's it's pretty well documented. So finally, you saw when we just looked at the config, you saw about the pools. The pools are configured this way. So this is where we're actually telling Designate these are the pools that you're going to be talking to and updating. So here we have the default pool. You can set attributes. So this lets you do things like you can see in the comments here, service tier, gold, capabilities, anycast, true, things like that that will go and help you discern what sorts of things you want a pool to go to. So eventually you'll be able to sort of like schedule things to happen at different pools. So you could just ad hoc example, say I work at Rackspace and I want to update a Rackspace domain and I want to add a subdomain or something like that. I might go and have that as a, that's going to go to this pool over here versus some generic pool. We have name servers, and one thing I do want to clarify, there's name servers and there's targets. So basically a name server is, a target is where you're pushing out the changes to, and a name server is where you're verifying. So for example, if you had two name servers and then those name servers had 10 slaves, you might make your targets the two name servers, but then if you want to verify that it was written on those, you check for the name servers, those are slaves. So that's kind of the concept there. So that is it for that. So now, yes. Yeah, so everybody's ran the script, right? I've rambled on for a while just in hopes that nobody had any problems running this script. But did anybody have any problems running the script? We have one hand right there. Is that it? Two?
Okay, I will take a quick pause while we check these.
Okay. Well, good job, right? Good job. Way to get, yeah, that's pretty impressive. All right, so we'll help you guys out.
So raise those hands up again if you have problems. So once more, raise your hand if you have any problems so that we can come around and get you set. There's one right there. right, we're gonna keep it on going here. So super quick, I just wanna do like a little poll here. If everybody could do what I'm doing here, just change directory, designate, and git branch. Give everybody a second. So CD designate, git branch. How should it be even bigger? Oh my God. So if yours does not say stable Mataka, could you just raise your hand really quick? Yes. Okay, so maybe it was literally just that one guy. All right, no big deal. No big deal, it's fine. Carry on. All right, so we're gonna show you how to use the OpenStack CLI so that we can actually interact with this baby right here. So the first thing we're gonna do is OpenStack zone list. Just kidding. The first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna source some user credentials. So, and before I go too far, lest you think this is all coming from the top of my head, there's a file called client.sh in the home directory where all the other stuff has been that we've done so far. This is what I'm working from. So I'm gonna kinda go through this with you and explain what's going on. So if you get lost or you didn't see a command, you can look in, it's just client.sh. So, so the first thing we wanna get, there's some, there's some user credentials in here. So if you just, there's two users and some admin credentials. So we're just gonna source the first user. So source openrc.user1. This is just getting some basic credentials so that we can interact with Keystone and designate. You can see it's just literally exporting a couple of variables that OpenStack uses. So with that, let's do a quick OpenStack zone list. And that's not what you didn't run the install script. Eric was so intent on showing you all the cool stuff that was installing that he literally did not install it. So hopefully you guys all did this. Awesome. Awesome. So here we go, we're almost done. All right, this better work now, Eric, or you're in big trouble. OpenStack zone list, boom. Oh no, there's nothing there. It's because we haven't created anything yet. So I'm gonna go ahead and type OpenStack zone create. Zones require an email address if you've ever seen a zone file. You'll know why. We're gonna do, let's follow the example. So one common mistake you might have seen, might have not, I typed openstack.org as the domain and put a trailing dot on there because that's necessary for it to be a valid DNS name. So that trips a lot of people up, is if you leave off that trailing dot, you can be in some trouble. So what you saw here is the zone object get created, action create, here's our name, openstack.org, and you can see a status pending. So designates an asynchronous API. So when you, just like Nova, if you create an instance, when you create a zone and designate, it goes from pending to active when the zone actually propagates to the name servers that E. Larson there mentioned. When those get pulled, you can go and get that happen. You wanna see the command again? Bam, OpenStack zone create. And remember, this is in client.sh. Well, you know what, I tried. OpenStack zone create. Yeah, so it might be better to just copy and paste these rather than doing them by hand like I'm gonna do. As you'll see, because I'm probably going to flub quite a few of them. So now that we've given it a minute, we can look and see that hopefully, yes, our zone has gone from a status of pending to a status of active. So what that means is that the zone successfully propagated to and was seen as active on the various name servers that were in that pools.yaml file that Eric mentioned. So that in and of itself is not a huge accomplishment because it's not, there's not really much you can see, but we can prove to you that PowerDNS locally, we just did a dig command and we got a status back that wasn't bad. So we can see that the zone actually did make it out there and there's an SOA record there. So let's go and actually create an A record. So again, this is gonna be a long one. So I would go ahead and type it out or copy it from the file. Remember, client.sh. So I'm gonna create an A record set. A record set is a logical grouping of DNS resource records that are gonna make it into PowerDNS. So get TTL. Yep. What did I do wrong? Dash dash record set. Wait for it. Thank you. All right, so I didn't give an actual name. So now you can see there's gonna be a record, foo.openstack.org, and it's gonna resolve to a localhost, which is totally unhelpful, but it's very helpful for this demo. So let's give that a second. And bam, we can see that the record set went active. So now if we dig for openstack.org, oh my goodness, there's the IP that we put in. Please clap. All right, so let's, so this is obviously a very simplistic example, but you can imagine if this was the IP of your Nova instance, you'd be super excited right now. Because now your instance has a name and you didn't have to send a support ticket, you had a command line client to do that. And we're gonna show you, you don't even have to do this. You can get it auto-created. So Miguel's gonna show that a little later. But so it was great, openstack.org, but now we're gonna kill you. So openstack.org, zone, openstack, zone delete, openstack.org. You can see we're gonna delete the zone just as swiftly as we created it. But don't worry, because we're gonna do something really awesome now. I have a DNS zone file. It's just import demo.txt sitting in your home directory. And this is the RFC defined DNS master format for zone files. And this is a thing that you can get out of basically any DNS provider. You can say, give me my zone file. This is kind of the standard format. You can see, you know, roughly the same kind of information that we put in when we created the record set is here. So we're actually going to import this zone file. So rather than having to go and make API calls or CLI calls to create all those record sets, Designate can do it all for us. So we're gonna do OpenStack zone import create and give it this file name. And here we have, this is another asynchronous resource because it's gotta go, this zone file could be ridiculously huge. So we give it a status as well. So if you take a look, OpenStack zone import list, you can see that it was complete. So now, if we take a look at our OpenStack zone list, bam, we have designatedemo.com. So, and then we can look for some of those record sets that were in the zone file. Whoops. Also, you may have completely not noticed this, but you can type, give me record set list, and then type the name of the zone. If you think about how a REST API works, which is what's actually happening under the covers, that's not what you would do. You'd be going and getting an ID. So that's just a nice little thing that's happening inside the CLI for you. Oh my god. What is it? Shell? No value. So you can see now, there's roughly, in a slightly different format that's in the Designate database, those records that we created via the zone import. So those are the same things that's in the zone file. Please clap. I'm kidding. Don't clap for that. So just to prove to you how awesome Designate is, now we're going to take that same zone and we're going to export it. So we can do OpenStack zone export create, and then just pass that same name. Another asynchronous resource. Hopefully next cycle we'll make this so that the zone files will end up in your Swift bucket, which would be pretty awesome. But the way it works now, let's see, bam, we are complete. I'm going to grab this ID real quick. And OpenStack zone export show file, and then pop the ID. That's not helpful. If you do dash F value on the end of your OpenStack CLI commands, it gives you a really helpful, it kind of takes away the default pretty table effects. So for these zone files, that's actually really nice. So if you take a look here, I'm going to put the zone import in a file. Well, they're roughly the same. So the output from that, the zone import or the zone export, is roughly the exact same thing as was in the import. So you can export and then import your zone and then export it again and import it again. I don't know why you'd want to do that, but you totally can. So the next thing I'm going to show you is the Python bindings, which is kind of an extension of the CLI, so that you can actually program in Python with this, the same type of goodness here. So I'm going to just create an example zone real quick that's going to be used by some of these. So I have example.com here. So if you take a look, there's a couple of .py files in this directory. The first one being example.py. So this is ludicrously simple. All it does is grab a Keystone session using the environment variables that are sourced from the user, and it creates a record for me.example.com. So let's just run that really quick. Python example.py. Really quick. Bam. Done. OpenStack zone record set list for example.com, and we're going to see that there was indeed a record set created using that Python stuff. So you don't have to use too much of your imagination to imagine how that might be really useful. Building, you know, small Python scripts that you might use to automate any sort of DNS-related deployment. And that's obviously a really powerful tool. Being able to just, you know, as a developer who only knows Python, you're not so sure about all this DNS stuff, it's super simple. So just in case you didn't actually see how simple that was, you just get the client, which is just the Designate client, client.recordsets.create. It doesn't get much more simple than that. So I'm going to give you a little bit of a more complicated example here. This is just a little script that we have here. And all it does is give you, you know, like a URL shortener like bit.ly, like we used earlier. You can use this to create like a random short URL. So if I do short URL example.com is my zone, and I want to put openstack.org as a CNAME record and get a, see, I didn't do a DNS name. So now if we take a look, OpenStack record set list, now you can see there's a random kind of short URL CNAME record for OpenStack.org. So just obviously the really simple explanation, please clap, that you could see could be a good use case here. Anything, if you can dream it, you can do it. So one of the next things I want to show you is I want to show you Horizon. So let's go here. That's 127.0.0.1. 8080 and then slash horizon. So I don't remember the creds. So we're using user one. It's the user. Yeah. So the username is going to be user one. Password is password. Super secure. We're going to log in here, go to the DNS panel, and oh my goodness. Those look familiar. We just created those earlier using the CLI. So you can see that these two clients, the Python bindings, the OpenStack CLI, Horizon, they're all using the same API. So all your stuff is unified. So really quick, you can go to like example.com here and click Manage Records. We could edit the records that we created, or we could create a new one. So you can see there's a lot of different types of records here that you can create. Maybe you can't really see that. A records, quad A, C names, SPF, SRP, TXT, all the good stuff that you actually want to create. And then it's smart. So you can, obviously you can go through and create some records and they'll show up for you. So this is pretty cool. And we're working on new panels. So if this wasn't awesome enough for you, we're going to get some of the new Horizon goodness in this cycle. So, what's up?
How did you get to your dashboard?
Oh, sure.
What's IP and then
8080? Yeah. Here, this is going to be a lot bigger. Horizon. And then the same credentials that are in the user one file that we used. So then the user, you'll want the username, so it's just user one and the password.
Where do you set up the IP of the actual DNS pool itself? So the client's got to have
the DNS record?
Yeah.
So okay, sure. So if you look at the pools.yaml file, right down here in this name server right here. So we can see we have an NS record of ns1.example.net. So for if you were setting up some private thing, this would be ns1.yourprivatething, .net. And then the actual name server that people would be resolving against would be this right here, the name server.
So in a real world environment, that would just be an IP on the external network?
External network, internal network, wherever you want, the clients to be able to resolve DNS against. So we've got PowerDNS installed locally, so we're able to just resolve against localhost. But in a real scenario, you would have many name servers that you might be pushing out to that could be just behind. You might also set ns1.example.net to point to whatever that name server was. Kind of a.
But But the DNS servers can be wherever you need them to be. So if you have existing DNS infrastructure, you can go and point it at that existing DNS infrastructure, whether that's in OpenStack or whether you have somebody with a DNS server under their desk or something like that. It does that, you know what I'm saying? But it also there's also other backends. So there's things like there's like a Dynect backend. So if you wanted to point it at Dyn DNS or something like that, you could do that too.
Come chat with us afterwards. You know, yeah. We'll be around. So we're going to kick it to Miguel, who's going to show you some of the awesome work to integrate Designate with Nova and Neutron.
Can you hear me? Yeah, you can.
Check.
All right. What we are going to show you is the work we did during this past Mitaka cycle to integrate Neutron with Designate. And essentially, the idea here is that we wanted all those commands that Tim has been showing to be done for you as much as possible. And so what we did was to add new DNS-related attributes to ports. To Neutron ports, Neutron networks, and Neutron floating IPs. So let's do a little help port create, and let's grab DNS. And as you can see now, since Mitaka, you can assign a DNS name to a port resource in Neutron. In a similar way, in the case of networks, you can assign a DNS domain attribute to a Neutron network. And finally, for floating IPs, you can see that for floating IPs, you can assign both a DNS domain, a DNS name, and a DNS domain attribute to floating IPs. And the idea here is that when you create these resources, depending on the way you have configured the integration between Neutron and Designate, once you create the resource, those attributes are going to be pushed to Designate, and therefore they are going to be pushed to the external DNS service. Okay, is that clear? So far clear? And so the other thing that we did was to integrate all these with Nova. So here's the general picture. So here's the general picture. That little person on the left-hand side of the slide, you can think of that as being Nova. And when you create that's Nova. When you create an instance, essentially what happens is that when Nova is allocating the ports for your instance, it's going to attach the instance host name to the DNS name attribute of the port that Nova is creating for you. And therefore, that gives us the foundation to push that information for you automatically to the external DNS service. The essential paradigm here is that if your port has a DNS name, the port that was used to create the Nova instance has a DNS name, and the network of that port has a DNS domain, Neutron is going to attempt to push that DNS name under that DNS domain to the external DNS service. And therefore, once you type the Nova boot command, automatically that information at the end of the boot command is going to be pushed to the external DNS service. Does that make sense so far? Not only we did that, we also maybe I'm pretty sure maybe many of you know that Neutron has its own internal DNS service. Each network in Neutron gets a DHCP server. So we integrated also that with Nova. And essentially, prior to Mitaka, all your ports got an automatic name, host name, and the IP address of the port in the internal DNS, Neutron internal DNS service. We changed that in Mitaka. Essentially, if you configure in neutron.conf a parameter named DNS domain with a value that it's not OpenStack local. OpenStack local is the default value for DNS domain in Neutron in the internal DNS service. If you change that to anything else other than OpenStack local, from that point on, the name of your port in the DNS name is going to be pushed to the internal DNS service in each Neutron network. And essentially, what you see there in that port dictionary is the result of creating a port from Nova. As you can see, the user is creating an instance named my_VM. What we do is we clean up that name to make it acceptable for DNS. So essentially that gets transformed to my-VM, which is an acceptable DNS label. Okay? And it's attached to whatever you have configured in DNS domain in the internal DNS service. So this DNS domain parameter in neutron.conf only applies to the internal Neutron DNS service, okay? But on top of that, if the network of that port also has a DNS domain, whatever name was assigned to it, that DNS name, my-VM, is going to be pushed to the external DNS service to designate. Does that make sense so far? Okay. So here's the general plan that we are going to do in our little VMs. We are going to source the OpenRC user one. We are going to do Neutron netlist to see the networks that user has created for it. We are going to see the flavors available in Nova. We are going to see the images available in Nova. And with that information, we are going to spin up an instance, okay? So let's just do that. Neutron netlist. And as you can see, that tenant one user has the network 638 something else assigned to it. So let's create a variable here. So I'm not that good with the. Oh yeah, I know how to do it. Okay. Okay. So we assign a variable there. Let's do a Nova image list. And we're going to use that image to boot our instance, so we are going to create another variable. And finally, let's do a Nova flavor list. And we're going to use the flavor 202. So with that information, we are going to say Nova boot image flavor 202, nick netid, and we are going to call our little VM my underscore VM. So it should become active pretty soon. Yeah, and it's active. So now let's use the Neutron client to find out what's the port for that VM. Neutron port list, device ID equal this VM UUID. And we can see that that's a port assigned to the, that Nova assigned to the instance. And with that information, let's do a Neutron port show. So if we go up, we can see that the DNS name assigned to that port was my-vm. And it got a DNS assignment attribute that has a host name of my-vm, the IP address, and a fully qualified domain name of my-vm, mydomain.org. Does that make sense? So the next thing we are going to do is we are going to assign to that network. We are going to update that network that we used to boot the instance with a DNS domain. So let's call that mydomain.org. The network was updated, so now Neutron net show that same network. And as you can see now, the network has a DNS domain of mydomain.org. Okay? Let's assign that port UUID also to a variable, so it's easy to manipulate. And what we are going to do is we're going to create now a floating IP, and we are going to assign that floating IP to the port. Neutron floating IP. Oh no! Before that, let's create the zone. The only thing that needs to exist prior to pushing the information to the DNS, the zone needs to exist, okay? So let's create the zone create. And we're going to call that zone mydomain.org. So now we have our little zone. So prior to creating the floating IP, let's see the record set list mydomain.org. So as you can see, there's really there's no useful information in that zone. So now let's create a floating IP. And And we're going to use external network that that user has access to. So Neutron, floating IP, create. Port ID, the port of the VM, which I assigned to a variable. And the floating IP was created. Now let's see what we find in the in our zone mydomain.org. And as you can see, now the floating IP assigned to the VM is known in the zone. And the name assigned to that thing is myVM, mydomain.org. Does that make sense? So there are essentially we have three use cases for this integration between Neutron and Designate. We can create a floating IP, and the floating IP is going to be if that floating IP has a port with a DNS name and its network has a DNS domain attribute, that DNS name and that DNS domain is going to be pushed to the external DNS service under the floating IP. So that's use case number one. Let's create another use case number two is also based on floating IPs, floating IP create. But in this case, the DNS name and the DNS domain are going to belong to the floating IP. It doesn't come from the port associated to the floating IP. Okay. So let's say DNS domain is going to be also mydomain.org, but the DNS name is going to be Moxie. So as you can see, we created the floating IP. And now let's see what we find under our zone. We have that name moxie.mydomain.org was also pushed to the DNS service. So that's use case number two. Essentially, what we said is, okay, we want one use case where the DNS attributes belong to the instance and the port associated to that instance. So that's use case number one. Use case number two is where we want the DNS attributes to belong to the floating IP. And you can create an instance, associate an instance to that floating IP, tear down that instance, create another instance and associate that instance to that floating IP, and you are not changing the DNS information for that floating IP. And use case number three, which I'm not going to show tonight, is where we publish the port DNS name and the network DNS domain attributes directly to the external DNS service without requiring a floating IP. That's for use cases where you are routing your ports directly to the outside without using floating IPs. So that's going to be use case number three. Okay. There's a follow-up session. That is going to take place this coming Thursday at 1:30 p.m., where we are going to see in depth the three use cases, and we are going also to review in depth the way to configure the integration between Neutron and Designate, all the files that you need to configure for this to happen. But as you can see, pretty much we can create an instance and get that instance's information pushed to the external DNS service. Okay.
about another minute. So I noticed a few people got lost a little bit through there. It can be hard sometimes to try and fit enough into the hour, so apologies for that. All right, so if you're interested in contributing to Designate, we're absolutely open to anybody and everybody coming along and giving us a hand. So that can be anything from code itself, the most obvious one, through to documentation fixes, filing bugs when you find our mistakes. All of these kind of things are really quite valuable to us. So I've included a whole bunch of links here. At the end, there'll be a link to the slides themselves. But for the most part, general OpenStack stuff. So if you're contributing to any OpenStack project, they kind of apply. And you've got some specific links for Designate itself. So things like the bug tracker, how we do specs, our documentation, and so on. All right, so if you are interested in getting involved, the way we mostly communicate in the Designate team is IRC. So we've got an IRC channel called #OpenStackDNS on Freenode. We also hold weekly IRC meetings at 1700 UTC in one of the OpenStack meeting rooms. So if you're interested in contributing a feature or helping out in any way, you can drop by. And other than that, it is questions time. So if anybody has questions, all the way at the back. So the question is, there are Designate resources in Heat. Will the Neutron Designate integration be usable via Heat today? I believe the answer there is no, you can't set the DNS name or DNS domain attributes on the Nova or Neutron resources in Heat yet. I'm not 100% sure, but I don't believe it can be entirely done. It's possible if you pre-set up some of it, that actually adding VMs. Yes, yeah, we'll go make sure that's done. Okay, so the question is, how easy or hard is it to run Designate behind a load balancer? So I'm going to assume what you mean there is HA, multiple copies of everything. Okay, so every Designate component, you can run multiple copies of it. Some of them behave slightly differently. So for example, the API, you can just scale that out as far as you want. Some other services like the pool manager service will sort of go into an active passive mode and fail over between themselves if you hit issues. So for the most part, yes, you can just run as many of everything as you like, and it will recover when any individual component fails.
And in production, what's the preferred DNS server?
So we have HP have always used PowerDNS. Rackspace
we use Bind.
Heavily involved in Bind. So there's also a couple of other Dynect and Akamai if you want to offload it to a professional DNS hosting company to actually manage the servers. But those two are the main ones.
Can zones be shared between tenants today?
Today, no. You can delegate subzones. So for example, if you have mycompany.com and you have a finance department, you can delegate finance across, but you can't currently share them. It is something we've talked about, but we've never come up with an elegant implementation for it.
Yeah, the sharing model has always been very difficult for us to write in a way that's going to be performant, but still allow people to actually use it in any meaningful way.
Does destroying floating IPs and things like that actually clean up the DNS afterward, or is that left out?
So the question is, does destroying and deleting resources like the floating IPs and VMs actually clean up the resources? Yes, it will.
Yes, and actually one thing that I didn't mention is that we not only create A records for IPv4, we create a records for IPv6, and we also create PTR records for your reverse lookups, which I didn't show, but I should have, yeah. but it was created actually during the demo.
Are there any planned Ansible modules?
Are there any plans for Ansible modules? Is this for things like the sort of OS Nova instance and so on? Honestly, I personally haven't thought of it, but I'm sure somebody
there
has.
There's currently a patch up to Shade, I don't know if you know it.
Shade is the underlying library that all of the Ansible modules, all of the OpenStack Ansible modules use to talk to OpenStack components. And there is a review to add designate components to Shade, which would be the first step towards getting them into Ansible. What DNS servers are we supporting right now is the question. So, sorry?
There's a page.
So right now we support Bind, ParaDNS, third-party hosting through Akamai, third-party hosting through Dynect, NSD, I think that's it at the moment. There is reviews up to add NOT, which is, NOT DNS. There's also one in progress for DJB Tiny DNS as well. Those haven't merged yet, though.
Can you manage multiple DNS servers? So if you have like a Bind server and another implementation, can you use a single instance to manage
multiple? So yes, you can either, the question is, can you manage multiple different DNS servers, maybe Bind over here, or ParaDNS over here? So yes, you can. In the pools configuration file, that YAML, you can define a pool that is made up of mixed DNS servers. For the most part, you don't want to do that, though, because different DNS servers will behave differently, and you actually get into weirdness. But if you have two different pools, you might have a Bind pool and an Akamai pool. So Bind might be for your internal stuff, Akamai for your external stuff. So that is sort of two ways of doing it. And any other questions or? All right, so thank you guys for presenting. 3 cheers.